there might be a spoiler of 50. Deltarune. The definitive sequel to the critically acclaimed game Nut Dealer was originally released as malware that everyone kind of just downloaded for fun. I, however, had not played the first chapter of it, mainly due to not knowing where to play it, and frankly not caring enough to look for it. But now, Toby Fox decided to drop Chapter 2 on everyone, and considering that I did really enjoy playing Nut Dealer, and for no other reason besides that, I played through the game with the sole intention to make a video for views. I mean, your entertainment. This thrilling tale starts with us making our own customizable character, which of course means it's absolutely vital that we make the stupidest looking character possible. His favorite food? Pain. His blood type? Well, he's extremely smart, so he should be able to easily ace the blood test. Color? These options suck. Green. A gift? His galaxy-sized brain is the ultimate gift. All, including myself, will fear him. Behold! My original OC, Death Killer. And after I input my own name, we're about to start the game when Toby Fox himself decides to yeet away my creation. No one's allowed to have OCs in this game except for him, which is why we get to play as Toby Fox's very own original OC. Chris Chan. The game starts when Toriel, Chris Chan's mom, this script was painful for me to write, wakes him up, and as all people do before going to school, he rushes to the bathroom to flush the toilet over and over again. It makes a fun sound that makes me feel like I just accomplished something. After doing that for about an hour, Chris Chan rides his mom's car through Furry Town, and once she drops him off, she gives Chris Chan a hug. Apparently, we're late because we spent the last hour flushing the toilet, so now we have no possible partner for the school project until a monster version of the bully from Bridge to Terabithia walks in.
Sup, bitches.
So we're forced to partner up with her. The teacher sends us to the closet to find Chalk, and I walk out to see the bully, Sussy, eating a nice, apparently flavorful piece of chalk. Uh-oh, she noticed that we saw her sabotaging the chalk. Oh, fuck. Sussy's the imposter, but she realizes that if she kills me here, everyone will know it was her since literally the entire lobby was in the classroom, so she leaves me alive so she can finish me off in electrical. She's not very good at the game. But as we go into electrical, the papers we were standing on suddenly give way and we fall to our deaths. Not really. But now, Chris Chan's turned blue for some reason, and we make our way down this pathway. We find Sussy in a pile of Fluffy, and she follows us around for a solid 5 seconds before determining that we're too slow and leaves us behind. But then we're attacked by spades, and using our incredible levels of skill, deftly avoid as many spades as possible and slide down this hill taking extra precautions to ensure that we don't get hit. Afterwards, we come across a ghost town where its only inhabitant tries its absolute hardest to exposition us when the game's best character makes an explosive entrance. Lancer, the bad guy, does the exposition rather than the boring guy in the robes. Apparently, we need to eat their fountain to destroy darkness to return home to Furryland, but the bad guys don't want that to happen, so we fight Lancer with the weapons that magically appeared on us, and after Lancer's bike runs out of fuel, not sure how considering it's just a normal bike that's on fire, he makes his escape, which allows Rossi to introduce himself. But before he can get a couple sentences in, Sussy leaves the party, forcing us to associate with the Prince of Super Weenie Hut Juniors. After he makes us aware of the fact that we can run with B, we practice the Art of Kindness on the dummy, and we also decide that we're gonna be pacifists since we are sophisticated beings, and genocide is for barbarians. Huh? You're wondering about Death Killer from earlier? Yeah, if he was my character, I would have made him a pacifist just for the irony. We traverse through the field of hopes and dreams to make me feel nostalgic over Nut Dealer, and we go about sparing enemies and reading Lancer's threatening signs until we come across this chef who had his cake smashed. Seems like Sussy came here first and beat the shit out of everyone in their path, including Lancer. This puzzle is quite difficult. I wouldn't be surprised if this was the hardest puzzle in the game. I spend a few minutes trying to figure it out when Prince Weenie Hut asks me if I had forgotten that I can sprint with the B button, to which I stood still for a bit thinking about this information. God damn it! Now that I had learned the puzzle's secret, we got through it effortlessly and continued on our way as Lancer threw an elite squadron full of support enemies to stop us in their tracks. Something that Weenie Hut points out, but unfortunately Lancer was unable to see any flaws in the strategy. Next, I try to solve this puzzle for a few minutes until I realize that no matter how fast I am, I'm gonna need Sussy, and she's probably nearby, so we walk to her and she joins the party begrudgingly while following from a distance. We make our way through the area, killing our enemies with kindness or extremely sharp objects. Why are you making my life difficult, Sussy? Until we encounter Lancer once again, who asks us what our official team name is. And since we don't have one, we each drop suggestions for team names in the bucket, which is cute and all. But little do they realize that since I am McJRPG Protagonor, my choice is the one that everyone on screen will gravitate to. And, oh, apparently I chose to make us the Lancer fan club. Afterwards, Lancer throws upon us his most terrifying minion yet, a being so powerful that upon acquiring the Crown of Gods, the K-Round grows in strength and sprouts long, elegant legs, which he uses to attempt to crush us like a watermelon between a pair of massive K-Round thighs. Disclaimer. I watch too much anime. After undergoing a duel to the death, the K-Round eventually drops its crown, causing it to revert back to its normal self, which is swell and all, but then this absolute beta male starts nagging Sussy for not doing things the same way a super weedy like himself would do, which causes Sussy to perform a Benedict Arnold and join the based Team Lancer. They declare that they are the Dark Lancer fan club, which is essentially the Lancer fan club, but dark. And as we're making our way through the forest, these two plot their evil shenanigans. But that's all they do. Plot. They're actually very lazy and don't get their evil plans done at all. Wow. They're just like me. So relatable. Soon though, we see Lancer. Oh wait, that's not Lancer. My bad. That's just a sweet innocent boy with an evil plan. This young lad wishes for us to create the most evil, despicable, terrifying monster to thrash my own ass. And thus, using my assortment of options, I have wrought upon the world a horrifying machination to be my own end. The young lad also finds it incredible. Oh shit, I was tricked. Sussy leaps out as if from a vent, and she and the not-so-innocent Lancer take off with the blueprint for the most destructive force created since controversial Twitter replies were released upon the world. We follow them through the forest. We reverse follow them, since Lancer's so bad at directions, he always goes the wrong way no matter where he goes. Until our godforsaken design appears before us. But they decide to blow it up because they think our design sucks. That's not very based of them. They begin a fight with us, and while the Sigma Sussy throws axes at us, the Beta Weedy Hutch sings some cringe tunes that make her fall asleep, allowing us to convince Lancer to- Oh wait, Sussy just ended the battle. Oh. Okay, that works. Sussy joined the team again. That's nice of you. Oh, it seems we're just combining team based with team cringe. Well, almost. Since Lancer just up and leaves us, and an army of royal soldiers corner us and throw us into their prison. Apparently, Sussy managed to smash her guard and throw him into the trash can. But since she doesn't do puzzles, we need to help her out since she doesn't have the mental capacity required to match shapes into their corresponding holes. Here's a hint, they all go into the square hole. And now that she's learned how to match shapes together, Sussy finds Lancer speaking to the guard about how we're not allowed to escape. Wow, what a plot twist. Lancer was a bad guy all along. No, but seriously, Lancer actually just didn't want his dad to hurt us. Wow, maybe you could have mentioned that before Sussy nearly rendered your corpse so mangled the crew wouldn't be able to tell what color dyed electrical. Sussy believes that maybe she can talk his dad into solving things peacefully, and Lancer agrees to go with it. And oh, thank God, Sussy, you're back. I was forced to actually spend time with this femboy so cringe, he makes me seem based by comparison. We pass the prisoners sitting in zoo cages, and now it seems Sussy wants to be a normal crewmate. So now we can control her for this last tiny section of the first chapter. Oh, this is where that optional crazy boss with the banger song is located. Well, I'm not gonna fight him in this video. Before you can challenge him, you have to find the Holy Grail in my uncle's basement, located in a haystack that can only be found after finding Waldo and learning his last name. And if I wanted to listen to Toby Fox's new catchy optional boss tune, I could just look it up on YouTube and listen to it while walking down the sidewalk thinking of random scenarios that fit the tune. Not that I do that or anything. Anyways, we continue to traverse through the castle, and we accidentally run into a trap. A slender being radiating with power appears from the light and declares that he is our greatest enemy yet. This dastardly villain, Rauxalessa Card, presents us with the strongest puzzle of our lives. A puzzle so sinister, so confusing, so disturbingly painful, that merely attempting this puzzle would corrupt your very soul- Oh, we just had to move the box over. God! Damn it! Without saying a word, we continue on, and we give Sussy her first task. We order her to flirt with the enemy. What the hell is wrong with Chris Chan? Obviously, Sussy refuses this, but since Beta Weedy Hut Boy pressures her into it, Sussy gives in and lets out her strongest flirt.
Ooh, hey babe.
And of course, this causes the enemy to leave in a similar fashion to a viewer clicking off a video they deem too cringe for them. This pisses Sussy off even more, and she won't do it again unless Weenie Hut does it. He makes an attempt. Personally, I think Sussy's was better, but of course the effect was the same. It felt awkward and left because the cringe was so great. Of course though, when McJRPG Protagonor flirts with one, it works instantly. Wow, he's just like Joker from Persona 5, who's a lot like me. We continue to progress through this dangerous castle until we realize that we walked into yet another trap. Rouxalessa card. Oh wait, it's pronounced rules card. Oh, that makes sense now. Appears once again and forces us to behold his ultimate puzzle. A puzzle exponentially more sinister, exponentially more confusing, and exponentially more disturbingly painful. It's a shame though that zero raised to any power is still zero. Wow, he's just as good at making puzzles as I am at making videos. Shortly afterwards, Rules Card brings back the thick boss from earlier, and in order to save time, I'm not gonna go over this one again that much, just know that Sussy decided to throw Weenie Hut to remove the crown, and I'm surprised that Beta Boy's soft skin was strong enough to knock the crown off. I think Rules Card congratulates us because he doesn't want Beta Incarnate thrown at him either. And he leaves his post, allowing us to progress to find Lancer talking to his father, who tries his best to resolve the situation peacefully. But when his father sees the protagonist and the less important ones alive, he threatens to hit Lancer with the Long Live the King unless we give up. Of course, I would never choose to lose just for a simple side character, even if he is the best character in this. But, as is McJRPG Protagonor tradition, Chris Chan chooses to kneel and potentially let himself die for his good friend. Wow, so noble. It's a good thing you have plot armor, or else that would have been a really stupid decision. Now we start the boss fight against the bad guy, and through a lot of bullet hell madness, we do our best to resort this matter peacefully, but because it doesn't really matter at all what we do, actually, I'm pretty sure it didn't matter if we went pacifist or genocide. I think the ending is the same regardless. What was I talking about? Oh, yeah, we beat the king. He sits there and babbles about being a changed man and stuff. I wasn't really paying attention, but Super Weenie Hut decided to cast a full heal spell on him because he's more naive than people who believe that politicians will do the things that they say they'll do when reelected. Which, of course, doesn't surprise me at all when the king just knocks us flat on our faces. He's about to finish off Protagonor when Sussy hits us with the character development. Then the king falls asleep due to Weenie Hut using his pacify spell, which of course he wouldn't have needed to do if he didn't. Well, whatever. But anyways, Lancer is completely fine with this, and we say bye to Lancer. Then Super Weenie Hut Jr. reveals that he is actually Omega Weenie Hut Femboy Jr. Supreme. And then finally, Sussy and I use the plot fountain to solve this area's situation and return home. Wow. Okay, back to our boring normal lives in Furry Town. And before Chapter 1 is finally wrapped up, we'd take a nostalgia trip through the town that has most of the characters from the original Nut Dealer. Even though this game isn't supposed to be related to Nut Dealer, I don't know. But we meet the funny meme skeleton who apparently befriended our mom last night. Chris Chan makes no comment. Oh yeah, then Chris Chan decides to be edgy and rips out his heart for no reason. Or maybe there was a reason. Surely Part 2 will give us more info on that, right? Anyways, Part 2 coming soon, by the way. So subscribe or else Chris Chan will pull out your-